Now, just as a, what I've started doing is the videos are now getting posted. If you have any questions about the homework, just search for my name on YouTube. I've started to put together, I've been on YouTube for years, but now I'm starting to put videos up there because it's a lot easier to find and get to. So with energy, and really it's mechanical energy. Mechanical energy, or generally energy as a whole, can be in two forms, kinetic or potential. With kinetic, it is how I tend to do it. I write KE, capital K, capital E, for just kinetic energy. And that's 1/2 mv squared. Potential energy can come in really in two forms. And actually, kinetic has a linear and rotational. And even now, since we've talked about various forms of linear to rotational conversions, M becomes I, V becomes omega. For potential energy, the main two that we're going to talk about, gravitational, PE, MGH, and then spring potential energy, 1/2 kx squared. So these are the four main types of energy, the main four places that I could put balls throughout the room. There is a another type of energy, and this is energy lost through friction. And this is the energy, I just write E typically, or E sub F. And that is friction force times distance. Now, in the most general of terms, general form of energy, E is force, or distance times force, or you could just, I should write force times.
Dr. Eschenberg, the KE and the PE, are those two different terms, or is that representing one value?
KE is kinetic energy, PE is potential energy. Okay. It could come in various forms. Potential energy could be gravitational or spring or both. If we wanted to add additional subscripts, you could do PE sub G, PE sub S, stuff like that. Sometimes I would write it as E sub G or E sub S.
But there you're not multiplying anything, that's true.
No. Yeah. The KE is not K times E, it's just one, it's just a double, two letters that are saying the same thing. Typically, yeah, I kind of agree that it's a non-standard way of describing things. I would say if I go energy, I would just write E, and if there's any subscript you want to differentiate it from the other E's, you could use that. I tend to just write PE or KE, and we'll become very familiar with that. So with this, and people talk about the general form of energy and work as force times distance. And if I take this ball and it's right here and I lift it upwards, what force am I working against? Working against gravity. So I've applied a force of mg from there to there. So if this was, so effectively, let's say this was a kilogram because the math works better. So the force is 1 newton of force. The distance is 1 meter. So it is 1 newton meter is the units of this work. So work units, the same as energy units, force newton, distance meter, or you could say kilogram meter per second squared times meter, which is just kilograms meter squared second squared. All of these are short or long form for the unit of energy, which is a joule. So 1 newton meter is a joule. 1 kilogram meter squared per second squared is a joule. And so that simplifies things greatly. If you looked at kinetic, 1/2 mv squared, mass is kilograms, velocity squared is meters squared per second squared, and that gives you joule. If you look at gravitational, mgh, kilogram, gravity, meter per second squared, h, meters, again we get joule. So out of all these complex arrangements of letters, we're still getting the same expression for joule. I'll get to spring in a couple of minutes. Now, the big form for gravitational is that you mainly have to look at the height differential and the mass, or basically the mass times the gravity itself. And what you notice is that as long as the objects are of the same height, same potential energy. So even a ball on an inclined plane, as long as that height is still the same, in all three cases, the potential energy is the same. So everything is based on height. So if I roll this ball across the table, what's the change in potential energy? Nothing. If I go from here to there, what's the change in potential energy? None. All you have to do is you have to look at the beginning point and the end point. Just like we were doing two-dimensional motion, you study the position at the beginning and the end. If I go from here and I go back up to there, what was the change in potential energy? Not rhetorical. Nothing. It didn't, as long as the beginning point was equal to the end point. I could do this. End point was the same as the beginning point. What was the change in potential energy? Nothing. So you need to pay attention to the beginning conditions and the end conditions. And yes, I know Dr. Eschenberg's being funny. But to those of you who don't remember this, I'll be the one laughing instead of you. So pay attention to what I've just said. It doesn't matter what goes, what occurs along the way. The critical thing is the beginning condition and the end condition. Understand those two points. As an example, we'll start with the basics. You have a ball that is at a height of 10 meters. There's no friction, there's no wind resistance, there's nothing. And we drop the ball, the initial velocity is zero. The question is, what is the velocity of the ball the moment before impact, and we still have gravity? Now, one way that we could do this is x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. And v is equal to v naught plus at. The initial velocity is zero in both cases. I'm going to say that my origin is at the beginning, and I'm going to say that down is positive. So if I start at the beginning, x naught is zero, so x is equal to 1/2 at squared. Now a in this case will be positive 10 since down is positive. And the only thing I have here is I do know a, but I don't know time and I don't know final velocity. Over here, I do know x, I do know a, but I don't know t. What we'll do is we'll take this, put it in there, and then we'll solve for both. So 2x over a is equal to t squared, or 2x over a is equal to t. Now I don't solve for t because I don't care about t. Final v is a square root 2x over a. And now I guess you could plug everything in. 10 square root 2 times 10 over 10. It's like 14.1, I think. Yeah, 14.14. So we have 14.1 meters per second. So that's one way that you could calculate a ball falling from a particular height. Or we could do this. If there's no friction, yay, no friction, the mechanical energy before is equal to the mechanical energy after. The top is 0.1, the bottom is 0.2. What do we know about energy? Energy can be a combination of potential energy and kinetic energy. So the combination of potential and kinetic energy before is the same as the potential and kinetic energy is after. With potential energy and kinetic energy at the beginning, which one is zero? Identify which of those quantities is zero. Is it the potential or the kinetic energy at the beginning? It's the kinetic. Why? Because it's not moving. At the end, which is zero, potential or kinetic? Because it's at the closest to the ground. It has no potential energy. So that's zero. So we're left with the potential energy at the beginning is equal to the kinetic energy at the end. The potential energy at the beginning, MGH, equals the kinetic energy at the end, 1/2 mv squared. One of the things that you notice in the first part, mass was not needed. Mass was never needed. That could be an elephant or a fly, and it would still have the same velocity at the bottom. Over here, the m's cancel. So it once again, this equation is mass independent. And now you solve 2gh, v squared, or v is the square root of 2gh. So square root of 2 times 10 times 10, and you're left with 14.1.
That's just two ways of solving for the same thing.
Two ways solving for the same thing, correct. Now, one of the things, why am I doing this? Well, A, I want to illustrate the fact that there are many ways to do things in physics. And also, there are better ways to do things in physics. One of the things that I thought about initially, I was trying to decide which was Dr. Eschenberg's favorite equation, the equation of motion or the equations of energy. Because if you need position or time first, go with motion. Primarily, if you need velocity first, go with energy. Just look at what we had to go through to get velocity with the equations of motion. Had to write two equations down, we had to figure out what time is, we had to plug it in the velocity equation, and then we had to, bam, work through it. With energy, kinetic is potential, solve for velocity, that's it, you're done. Energy is much faster to use than motion when working with velocity. Now for position, you'd still need the equations of motion, but for velocity, it is a cutthroat way of doing things. All right, so that illustrates the conversion of one form of energy into another. Another way of converting another form of energy into another is we have a ball sliding with a velocity initially of 10 meters per second. The coefficient of kinetic friction on this surface is 0.1. How far will it slide before it comes to a stop? That's the question. So you have an object, you have a coefficient of kinetic friction, you have an initial velocity. How far does it move before it comes to a stop? The equation that I like to initially add, or if I'm going to add to it, is initially conservation of energy. So the energy before is equal to the energy after, but energy with friction, the energy before minus the energy released through friction is equal to the energy after. So if you have friction, boo friction, the energy that you have initially minus the energy released through friction is the final energy. Now, one of the ways that the analogy that I use for this is I call this particular equation the checking account equation. What's your balance at the end of the day? Well, it's the balance that I had at the beginning of the day minus the money that I spent, and that's the energy or money that I have left at the end. So, what's the money at the beginning? The initial energy. What's the money that you spend? The energy released through friction. What's the energy at the end? That's the balance at the end of the day. How is energy released through friction? Slide your hand across a rough surface. What happens? It gets hot. energy is being, kinetic energy, the energy coming from your hand by rubbing over the surface. The surfaces are colliding with each other and they're producing heat. They're releasing energy. And so that's where it typically goes. In this particular experiment, we've got friction. So that is what we're looking at. Now we're dealing with a flat surface. So in this particular case, we don't care about the change in potential energy. It could be on a cliff, it could be under the ocean, as long as it's on a level surface, it doesn't matter. But what's my final energy in this particular situation? It came to a stop. So the final energy is zero. It's not moving. Kinetic energy is 1/2 mv². If that is zero, then the whole thing is zero. So that's zero. Now initially it's moving. So it's 1/2 mv², or you can say v naught, it doesn't really matter. The equation of force, frictional force times distance. So 1/2 mv² is equal to frictional force times distance. Now this is where other things come into play. Object is sliding across the surface. You have normal force, you have the force of gravity pulling down, and it is equal because it's not moving off or on or into. So the sum of the forces in Y are equal to zero. Normal force minus mg. So normal force is equal to mg, and friction force, which is mu sub k, normal force is equal to mu sub k, mg. So this becomes 1/2 mv² equals mu sub k mgd. Once again, my mass is canceled. This thing could be an elephant sliding across the surface, or it could be a fly sliding across the surface. As long as their initial velocity and coefficient of kinetic friction are the same, the distance will be equal to each other. So this is v² over 2 mu sub k g is equal to d. In this particular case, we're converting all of the kinetic energy into energy released through friction. V, 10² 2 mu sub k 0.1 gravity 10. And this should be 50. So it slid 50 meters before coming to a stop. Now, one of the things that we could also do is, well, how much energy did we have to begin with? Well, 1/2 mv², 1/2 times, did I say 10 kilogram object? I didn't, oh, it doesn't matter. But in this particular case, it does. So it's 500 joules. So we initially had 500 joules, and at the end we had 0 joules. Because it's at rest. So the energy released through friction is 500. So energy lost would be 500. The change in energy would be -500 because it went down. There's all sorts of things. Now, in the grand scheme of things, the energy of the universe did not change. It merely converted 500 joules from kinetic to potential, or kinetic to friction. When they ask you in lab, is energy conserved? You may want to ask them, well, what kind of energy are we talking about? Mechanical energy or the energy of the universe? Because some of the TAs are trying to get sneaky on you, and they'll slide that conservation of energy, and then they'll chuckle to themselves and say, oh, I meant the energy of the universe, and take points. So shove it right back at them, is what I say. Now, in the beginning of the lecture, we had talked about energy of springs. And we need to cover something first. No, it depends on the situation. It really depends. Because if I could give examples where it's still moving at the end, but you have friction along the way. This table is frictionless except for a 3 meter stretch along the length. I throw an object across the floor at 10 meters per second. It's moving 2 meters per second on the other side. Where did the energy go? How much energy is lost? What's the kinetic, or what's the coefficient of friction in that region? So it can change. With Hooke's law, you have a mass M on a spring. And if it's not moving anywhere, you've got its rest position. If that spring is stretched, if you pull that mass back, what do you notice happening? That there is a force in the opposite, in to the left. If you compress that spring, there's a force to the right. There is something else that we need to talk about, and that is delta X. Delta X, or sometimes they use X, is the displacement. If the delta X is to the right, that X or delta X is greater than zero. If it is pushed to the left, that delta X or X is less than zero. Here, that change in X is zero, and the force is zero. One of the things that you've observed from these three situations is X is always opposite of force. If the force is positive, which means the force is going to the right, the displacement is going to the left. If the force is negative, which means the force is going to the left, the displacement has to bend to the right. And this brings up Hooke's law, which is this. Now notice I have vector signs all over the place. So the force vector is the opposite of the position vector. I'll explain K in just a moment. Really, its displacement vector is more accurate. Now, the negative sign just says F is always opposite of, oh, what was that? Opposite of X vector. And then there's K. K is the spring constant. K lets you know about the spring itself. So if it is not springy, which means it's kind of a weak spring, has a low K. If it is very springy, has a high K. So with stuff like this, you can kind of get an idea just by the value of K itself, what type of spring you're dealing with. Now, how I tend to work with Hooke's Law I like to deal with magnitudes. Because if I know the displacement is to the right, I know for a fact that the force is to the left. If I know that the displacement is to the left, I know that the force is to the right. Much like we worked with reference angles and our magnitudes of the vector components. What did we do with that? We determined the magnitudes first, and then I looked at it and said, it's a third quadrant vector, so the components in X and Y have to be negative. The displacement is to the left or negative, so I know that the force is to the right. So a lot of times when I just write F equals KX, I'm going to use all or positive because I know for a fact which way the forces are going, and I don't like to bother with the negative signs. And really, the important thing is just to get the magnitudes of this thing. Once again, I reiterate that negative signs are rather slippery, and yes, you could exclusively use F is negative KX, but the problem is if you take negatives of negatives and then negatives of negatives of negatives, and you don't really know what's going on, you tend to make mistakes. So I tend to use that, and then I use logic to determine the signs of what I'm dealing with. Now let's do a simple example. Spring hanging, mass M, the mass is 10 kilograms. I'm on the planet Earth, so gravity is 10 meters per second down. And what happens? We know that mass, if you had that mass at its rest position and you let go, that mass would fall. So the X is down, so the force is up. And this is also one of the reasons why I don't use negative signs and that F is equal to KX. I let the logic of where these forces are heading determine whether or not they're positive or negative. And I'll say up is positive and down is negative. Now, one of the things that you could ask is, well, what is it doing? It's doing nothing. It's just sitting there. And by the fact that it's sitting there and doing nothing, it's doing so much. Because it's doing nothing, it's in translational equilibrium. So if it's in translational equilibrium, the sum of the forces in Y is equal to zero. It's not doing anything. It's not accelerating anywhere. So if it's not accelerating anywhere, A is zero. If A is zero, sum of the forces, or MA, is also zero. The force up, the force due to the spring. The force down, the force due to gravity. So the force due to gravity is the force of the spring. The force due to gravity is mg. The force due to spring is kx. Now where's the negative? Well, I've already said that the force of the spring is up. So I don't need a negative sign because I know the force is up or the force is positive. So use logic and use magnitudes when playing with these equations. So mg over x is equal to k. M is 10, g is 10. Ooh, I didn't get, I need to give you information. This x right here is 1 meter. Otherwise, we can't solve this. So the answer is 100. Well, what is K? What are the units of K? Mass, kilograms. Gravity, meter per second squared. X, meters. So, we could cancel the meters and we end up with kilograms per second squared. But really, what is kilograms meters per second squared? That's a newton. So the units of K are primarily expressed as a newton per meter. For every meter you stretch a spring, it will give you K newtons of force trying to pull that spring or push that spring back into its rest position. Now, another experiment that we could do, let's take that spring and we'll put it on the side. Ten kilograms. We've compressed it a distance of 2 meters. It is a frictionless surface. Yay, no friction. And that the initial velocity of this object is zero. So what we're doing is a lot like the two-dimensional motion experiment where you push the ball into the spring and then you release it. What's the velocity of the object as it leaves the cannon? Well, the initial energy is equal to the final energy. How do I know this? Because I've said, yay, no friction. If mu sub k is zero, there is no friction, and we don't have to worry about that pesky friction bothering anyone. The initial energy, well, what is it? It's potential energy or spring potential energy. The energy final is kinetic energy. We're dealing with a flat surface, so we don't have to worry about all that pesky change in potential energy. So now, potential energy of the spring, 1/2 kx squared, what we listed at the beginning. The kinetic energy at the end is 1/2 mv squared. Halves cancel. Now I'm looking for the final velocity, so it's kx squared over m is v squared, or x square root k over m is equal to v. Now one of the things that I want to reiterate is the main advantage that Alphabet Soup has over Plug and Chug. With this particular way, I could ask for x, k, m, or v, and you could be able to solve for all four variables. It doesn't matter what set of numbers I give you. if you have the master core equation to solve for them. In this case, I am looking for V. X is 2, K is 100 newtons per meter, M is 10, so it's 2 times the square root of 10, 6.32 meters per second. And one of the questions that I have to ask is, if I suddenly, this isn't a pop quiz, but if I finally said, well, give me the energy after and divide it by the energy before, what number should that be? Should be 1. If you look at this, the energy before is equal to the energy after. Just move that one down, and it should be 1 is equal to E2 over E1. If there is no energy loss, you get that. If friction is in the system, if you took the initial energy, or actually if you took the final energy and divided by the initial energy, what would that ratio be? Greater than, less than, or equal to 1? It would be less than 1. Because energy final would be less than energy initial. And so a smaller number over a bigger number would produce a ratio less than 1. So understanding what goes on with these energies and where does the energy go is very important. If I say energy fraction remaining, well, that's just what I've talked before, E2 over E1. If I say energy fraction lost, it's 1 minus E2 over E1. So there are problems where I go, well, what's the fraction of energy lost? What is the fraction of energy remaining? Stuff like that. If I ask for percent, then you just multiply it by 100. That's no big deal. All right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to kind of make things a little bit more complex in one more example. And then I got to talk about other things. Now, in what I'm going to do is have an object at the top of a hill. At the top of the hill, there's an object. Its initial velocity is 0. It comes down to the bottom of the hill. There's no friction from A to B. Once it reaches point B, it comes to a flat surface where there's a coefficient of kinetic friction 0.2. If the theta is equal to 30 degrees, and that length there is equal to 20 meters, what is that distance D before it comes to a stop? Now, what we can do is we could do this in two different ways, and we'll get the same answer. One is to go from A, set of A conditions, to the set of B conditions, to the set of C conditions. Or we can go from the set of A conditions straight to set of C. And why can we do this? Because we know that the energy that we had at A is equal to the energy released through friction, which is how we get to C. At C, that final velocity is zero. Or we could go from here. The energy at A is equal to the energy at B, which is equal to the energy released through friction. So we can go from there to there to there. And it's one of those things where if you said A is equal to B and B is equal to F, you could say A is equal to F. It doesn't matter. If we were to do this in two parts, the part that we need to point out is that the potential energy is based on that height H. That height is based on H and theta. I never gave you H, so you're gonna have to find out. Sine theta is H over L. So that height is L sine theta. It doesn't matter how long it is. It doesn't matter the angle that it's at. All that matters is what's the change in vertical height. So the energy at A is all potential energy. The energy final is the frictional energy. So friction force times that distance D. Because there's no change in potential energy, the final, well, there is, but it's from A to B. So it gives up potential energy there, and then it expends its kinetic energy into friction energy and ends up there. Potential energy at A is just mg times h, which is L sine theta. The frictional energy is mu sub k mg. The distance is d. So that goes away, and it's L sine theta over mu sub k is equal to d. So L 20 sine 30 over mu sub k 0.2. So that's 10 divided by 0.2, or 50 meters. So without knowing any of the information at point B, I can go from A to C. It doesn't matter. Because here, the balls were all out in front of you. Here, some of the balls were in the drawers. There, all the balls were thrown out the window. Now let's go from A to B to C. EA, well, that's just MGL sine theta. That's all the potential energy. At B, it's all kinetic energy. 1/2 MV squared. So the M's cancel. I'm left with 2GL sine theta is equal to V squared, or square root of 2GL sine theta is equal to V. So this is square root of 2 times 10 times 20 times sine of 30, which is equal to square root of 200. Whoops. Whoopsie. 14.14. meters per second. And now what we could also do is, for here, this was the energy at A is equal to the energy at B. Now we can do energy at B is equal to the frictional energy released. Because truth be told, energy at B minus energy of friction is the energy at C, which is zero. So that just moves over there, and then we get this. Energy at B, 1/2 mv squared, is equal to energy final, which is mu sub k mgd. And then I'm looking for D. So I get this. The V, 14.14 squared, 2 times 0.2 G10. So really, 14.14 squared is 200 divided by 50. So in one particular case, we went from beginning to end really fast. In the other case, we took a brief pause along the way and found the final energy. The end result is the energy is conserved. Energy is converted totally into frictional energy. Now, mechanical energy is not conserved. So, the energy final divided by energy initial will be zero. All of the energy was converted into heat, sound, change in surface of whatever was rubbing up against each other, stuff like that. And so this is another way of you can go from directly from the beginning to the end, because in the end, all the energy is converted. A couple last things before we head out. You're gonna see this thing called impulse. An impulse is defined as the change in momentum with respect to time. So, impulse is the change in momentum. Basically, you know what the momentum is and before and after, and then you know the change in time. Also, the last thing that I really want to get across, number 11 in the problem set we talked about last week, center of mass of the system of particles. The last thing that we'll talk about is collisions. And really, for impulse, I'll talk about that on tutorial and other stuff. And there's some examples. I mean, really, it's just plug and chug. For collisions, there are two types. Inelastic and elastic. For inelastic collisions, only momentum is conserved. P1 is equal to P2. Momentum and energy, mechanical energy, are conserved. So an inelastic collision, only momentum is conserved. An elastic collision, momentum is energy is conserved. We will primarily concern ourselves with inelastic. Elastic collisions will only be multiple choice only. Now, why is it multiple choice only? Well, elastic collisions are a very complex two equation, two unknown solution. If this was honors 213, I would give you an elastic collision and then let you guys chew on it for a week and then go, well, here's an inelastic collision. You'll be done in 5 minutes and you'll go, I'd much rather do inelastic. So I'm gonna save us all the trouble and say, you don't want to get into that elastic collision stuff because it just gets crazy. For inelastic collisions, now really, why are we concerned primarily with inelastic collisions? Because it is the majority of all collisions are inelastic. Two football players running into each other, that's an inelastic collision. You smacking into a wall or someone hitting another person in the face, that's all inelastic collisions. Energy is released. And with an elastic collision, I only saw one example where an elastic collision happened, and there was a professor who wrote up a problem where two carts with magnets came at each other and they never touched. The moment something touches, you create sound, you create friction, energy is released. With elastic collisions, you have to get very specific about that. For inelastic collisions, there are three main sources of the deformation of the object. Two football players hit each other. What happens? All that muscle and mass are just changing shapes. You see the shock waves of the collision pass through their bodies. Sound. Two people smacking into each other creates a lot of sound. And so that's in what is sound? It's the energy of the atmosphere feeling the vibrations of the people hitting, and also heat released. Whenever you have two objects hitting each other, they slide across each other's surface. This creates friction, which creates heat, and so energy is released through that way. And so pretty much all real collisions are inelastic. If Eschenberg students know how to add vectors, Eschenberg students know that the acceleration of an object at the top of the curve is downward at 10 meters per second per second. And they all know that inelastic collisions only conserve momentum. If you do an inelastic collision and you start to conserve energy during a test, I will start to nervously twitch because I can tell that you're doing something hideously wrong. Do not conserve energy in an inelastic collision. How do you know? Well, the first thing is simple. I will not give you an elastic collision on the test or the final. It won't happen. So you can just rest assured it's going to be inelastic. But if you see the words stick, change shape, pass through, you're dealing with an inelastic collision. So inelastic collision, only momentum is conserved. Do not conserve energy. And so with stuff like this, and what we'll do is on Thursday, we will go all through inelastic collisions thoroughly. And with that, I'm done. See you on Thursday.